Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is Dr. Paul. Once again, thank you very much for tuning to our channel. As always, you can visit us at www.usmlevideos.net. That is www.usmlevideos.net. Tonight, I want to talk about obstructive sleep apnea, or otherwise called obstructive sleep apnea, hypopnea. And I would say WASA for the sake of brevity. WASA, most notably the physiologic improvements and enhanced quality of life, are the rules. I mean, they are the objectives to achieve. Now, I want to talk just the management in this video. In general measures, the first thing is weight control. Most of these patients are obese. They are overweight. So we need to educate patients to reduce their weight. That's becoming a problem in our time. People are addicted to food. They are becoming obese. And this is affecting all of our society. Most of them go bankrupt in their 30s and go on welfare. And many of them suffer with depression, heart attack, and hypertension, sleeplessness. And all these problems which have both impact on the quality of life and also the economy. So I want to talk basically about the general measures and specific measures. In general measures, it is the weight loss, then avoidance of alcohol, then safety measures. Now, first of all, weight loss. It is good to lose the weight, because as the patient loses weight, his obstructive sleep apnea improves. That has been proved in many, many studies. Obstructive sleep apnea is measured by AHI, that is apnea, hypopnea index. Some of these terms are a little bit difficult to pronounce. I have this problem. So AHI is apnea hypopnea index. This is very, very important to understand the severity of this disease and also to plan the management. Now, these patients should be encouraged to lose weight, to stop drinking alcohol, and also to be careful when they are driving. Every year, thousands of people die on the roads in vehicular accidents because of sleeping behind the wheel. And obstructive sleep apnea patients should be encouraged and educated very specifically to stop drinking. And also, if they are on benzodiazepines, they should avoid benzodiazepines. And you should give them safety warnings like not to drive and be careful around some machinery that could hurt these people. So, and could hurt others. For example, if you're an airplane pilot or a bus driver, you should stop their occupation and to change their occupation. Now, specific measures. In specific measures, number one, we have CPAP. Number two, oral appliances. And number three, surgery. And the criteria for selecting these patients, it varies. First of all, we start with a diagnostic test, that is polysomnography. Then we estimate the AI, that is apnea index, that means number of apneic events per hour of sleep. So sometimes we add even hypopnea. So this becomes apnea hypopnea index. Now let me talk a few minutes about the surgery. Number one surgery we have is UPPP, that is uvulopalatopharyngoplasty. This is also a big word, but basically what it is in uvulopalatopharyngoplasty. So the first word is uvula. Uvula is resected. The main aim is to make airway. You see, posterior pharyngeal wall, anterior pharyngeal wall. So we want to increase its size so that there will be more exchange of air from top to bottom and the patient can feel well because of that improved circulation of air. So you start with polysomnography and you take the AHI and you also measure oxygen desaturations. That is very, very important. When you take polysomnography, you can actually measure the number of times the patient goes into oxygen desaturations. So if the patient has more oxygen desaturations, even in the presence of less AHI, that's a clear indication for the definitive treatment of obstructive sleep apnea. The CPAP is a continuously sending air into the patient's airway, and the CPAP, it needs a definitive air pressure, otherwise it's just useless. So we give nasal prongs and nasal masks, and we encourage patients, because there are many nasal masks just to the idea is to prevent the air leaks. So there are definitive air masks or nasal prongs, so they should be given accordingly based on patient's preference and patient's face. And many of the CPAP machines come with humidifications, and some come with ramp feature. This is like a patient sleeps with a low pressure, and it builds up after some time, and when the patient sleeps, it goes to its required pressure. The idea is to make patient comfortable before he sleeps with a low pressure of CPAP. So CPAP, it comes in all kinds of definite things. I mean, we have now automated CPAP machines, and many patients, they want automated CPAPs because they come with so many features. So CPAP is number one treatment in the management of obstructive sleep apnea, and you always should know the compliance, because many patients are not compliant to this therapy. That's why you need to make telephone calls. Are you using it well? How many hours are you using it? How many nights per week are you using it? What pressure are you using it? Because like 60% of patients do not maintain their compliance with the CPAP machine. That's why we have nowadays computerized data. The CPAP machine, one good thing is you can get all the data from the CPAP machine itself to see whether patient is compliant or not. That's a marvelous feature that this patient, this machine has. So patient has to be educated, the complications. If obstructive sleep apnea, if you leave it untreated, all the time, it can cause stroke, it can cause heart disease, it can cause ischemic heart disease, congestive heart failure, and even conditions like hypertension, they become resistant to treatment if you do not address obstructive sleep apnea. Even diabetes mellitus, patients develop insulin resistance as their obstructive sleep apnea gets worse. Sometimes you don't have to start them on medications. All you have to do is to treat their obstructive sleep apnea so they get more insulin sensitivity.